Good afternoon. My name is Kirill Gerstein, and you've tuned into Kirill Gerstein Invites, an online forum hosted by Kronberg Academy. I'm very grateful for their continuing support of our gatherings here. It's a live seminar forum where you are most invited and welcome to contribute comments, questions. It's a live event. And I'm thrilled today to be welcoming Dr. Michael Haas. Michael is a man that wears a number of hats. He is an award-winning producer. From 1977 to 2017, he worked with conductors such as George Scholti, Christoph von Dohnányi, Ricardo Chailly, and Claudio Abbado. He, at Decca Records, initiated the series Entartete Musik, the first retrospective by a major recording label of major works banned by the Nazis. And in fact, the poignant musical excerpt of Victor Ullmann's Kaiser von Atlantis opera that you just heard during the welcoming minutes of the seminar is coming from a recording that Michael initiated. He was the curator of the Vienna's Jewish Museum, in charge of music, and then founded the Exile Arte Center with Professor Gerald Gruber. The Exile Arte Center is focused on repatriating the estates of musicians, scholars, and executives who were persecuted or exiled by the Nazi regime. And I'm thrilled to welcome him here today. He will speak about music forbidden by the Nazis. And Michael titled his talk, German and True. And this is a quote from Meistersinger. And perhaps this is a point to depart from for today's discussion. Welcome, Michael.
Okay, very good. Thank you very much. May I start my presentation then in that case?
Yes, please.
Good. Well, the title of this talk is taken from the final scene of Wagner's opera, Die Meistersinger von Nürnberg, in which the anti-Semite Richard Wagner, in his self-penned libretto, highlights attributes that were virtues of the German people, but with an admonishment to resist non-German invaders, which over time came to imply racial and cultural exclusion. This is a talk about the contributions made by German, Czech, and Austrian Jewish composers banned by the Third Reich and whose music was lost, exiled, or suppressed. In the photograph that you can see from the first festival of what would become the International Society for Contemporary Music in Salzburg, 1922, only five of the 14 composers shown in the photograph would not be listed in the Nazi Directory of Jews and Music. And of those, only three are neither German nor Austrian. The German, Paul Hindemith, and the Austrian, Anton Webern, would have their music banned by the Third Reich as so-called cultural Bolsheviks. The definition of German, meaning to come from Germany, has only been with us since 1945. Before then, what was German and where Germany was to be found was debatable. Prussia's blood and iron unification of the network of Germanic mini-states in 1871 only made matters worse. Many people who identified themselves as Germans were left out, such as German-speaking Austrians, and many who did not were considered Germanic by pan-Germans in both Germany and Austria. One small minority that lived in Germany and Austria that was cautiously eager to join the German club was Jews. Liberal constitutions passed in Austria-Hungary in 1867 and the German Reich in 1871 allowed Jews to progress towards full citizenship in all of its rights, privileges, and obligations. The Enlightenment within German-speaking Europe is underrated when compared with its French or English counterpart. Yet the social, political, and philosophical upheavals that grew out of it were far-reaching. A humanist, liberal, and tolerant Germany was not a distant dream, but the presumed natural condition of German speakers. For Jews, after centuries of exclusion, to claim this culture of Dichter und Denker, poets and thinkers, as their own became a fatal obsession. In Germany, A Winter's Tale, an epic poem in 27 Kapitel from 1844, the German Jewish poet Heinrich Heine reveals his ambivalence. In the introduction of Germany, A Winter's Tale, Heine dreams of a world that would be dominated by Germany. Indeed, quote unquote, Germany would rescue God from the indignities that inhabit mankind here on earth and thus redeem God himself, end of quote. Yet in the final verses, in which he sees a vision of Germany's future, he foretells the ovens of Auschwitz exactly 100 years later. What I saw, I shall not say, to silence I am vowed. Indeed, I hardly dare describe the stench enfolding cloud. With reluctance, I recall that dreadful cursed smell. It seemed a mix of unwashed masses, ovens from a tannery in hell. Central to the Jewish Enlightenment, or the Haskalah, was Felix Mendelssohn's grandfather, Moses. With the integration and enfranchisement of the middle classes following from the Congress of Vienna in 1815 would come a slow but steady recognition of the need for Jewish enfranchisement and integration as well. The bourgeois boom would have inevitable consequences on the arts, which previously had been the unique preserve of the aristocracy. With the emancipating constitutions of 1867 and 1871, Jews could start the process of assimilation and legal acceptance. As the middle classes annexed the arts as a demonstration of their social entitlement, it would be inevitable that recently emancipated bourgeois Jews would also view this as an area in which they would be seen to contribute to the greater German cultural good. Obviously, there were Jewish musicians before the advent of the two emancipating constitutions, but inevitably it required the participants such as Felix Mendelssohn, Ferdinand Hiller, Jakob Baer, also known as Giacomo Meyerbeer, and even Offenbach to be virtuoso instrumentalist. Nearly all of them had to make their names outside of Germany, and in addition, nearly all of them came from wealthy families who already enjoyed the special privileges bestowed by emperors and kings on a few financially indispensable Jewish households. What followed for most of the other Jewish composers in the immediate aftermath of the emancipating constitutions was a period of socially enforced musical conformity. Such conformity was belittled by Richard Wagner and expanded into the far greater lie that Jews had nothing original to say as musicians. Only after Wagner's death in 1883 could Jewish composers start to assert in Germany and Austria their true individuality. First, and perhaps most important, though today largely forgotten, was Karl Goldmark, but most crucially, with Gustav Mahler, all remaining psychological barriers to creativity were simply blown away. He was the first to free successive generations of Jewish composers from the curse of convention. There was only one major obstacle to the liberal visions of the final quarter of the 19th century. Europe's German speakers had not been united within a single state. Prussia, through a series of wars, had managed to bludgeon most of the German mini-states into a united Reich or empire. Austria's German speakers were excluded. To make matters more pressing for aspiring Austrian pan-Germans, they were in a minority within the Austro-Hungarian Habsburg realm. The resentment of exclusion was a feeling that would carry over generations and at one extreme produced Adolf Hitler. But on the other, there were very many German Austrian Jews who equally felt left out. They resented having to live in a state dominated by Slavs and Hungarians, whom many German speakers during these Darwinian final decades considered racially inferior. If there was an Austrian as opposed to a German identity at all, it was felt by those who lived in the furthest reaches of the Habsburg Empire in today's Poland, Ukraine, and Balkan Peninsula. For them, German was merely a language, a linguistic tool not a cultural or racial identity. By contrast, those Habsburg citizens who lived in the German-speaking realms consisting of today's Austria, plus South Tyrol, along with parts of Moravia and Bohemia, felt themselves to be culturally, racially, and linguistically German. For them, there was no Austrian identity. Austrian was supranational, and with German, a unifying linguistic unity, a utility, a bit like English today in places like South Africa and India. It was not a cultural identity. Yet the composer Karl Rathaus, born in Polish-speaking Ternopil in today's Ukraine, only thought of himself as Austrian. The Viennese composer Hans Gall saw himself as culturally German. Austria didn't figure for him or most others born in the German-speaking regions of pre-1918 Austria. A trajectory of Jewish musical assimilation is best understood if we look at the following personal account. Isaac Schrechka, the Jewish father of the Viennese composer Franz Schreker, had been court photographer in Budapest to the Emperor Franz Josef and Crown Prince Rudolf. Since obtaining the royal seal of approval in 1871. In 1869, marriage between Jews and non-Jews was legalized. In 1874, he divorced his Jewish wife, converted to Protestantism, and changed his name to Ignaz Ferenc Schreker before placing an advertisement in the paper in search of a new, presumably non-Jewish wife. The success of this venture must have come as an enormous surprise with his marriage to the penniless goddaughter of the Princess Eleonora Maria Windischgrätz. His new wife, Eleonora von Klossmann, was related to the families of Thurn und Taxis, Fürstenberg, Lobkowitz, and Waldstein, Austria's most blue-blooded aristocrats. Equally characteristic of this new age of social emancipation was the fact that in 1912, Wilhelm Pickel von Wittgenberg, the son of Eleonora von Klossmann's older sister, would compile what became a notorious directory of aristocratic families who had intermarried with Jews, called the Weimar Historisch-Genealogen-Taschenbuch des gesamten Adels jüdischen Ursprungs, was simply known as the Semigotter. In fact, von Wittgenberg was no anti-Semite. Instead, he wished to demonstrate how liberalization had facilitated the social rise of formerly excluded Jews into the highest realms of society, including his own family. The Nazis, however, took his directory and turned it against the very principles von Wittgenberg had employed for their own anti-Semitic propaganda purposes. Franz Schreker, now spelling his name without the C, born to Eleonora and Ignaz in 1878 during a family stay in Monaco, would be the object of virulent anti-Semitic attacks in the immediate lead up to Hitler. Schreker, whose works are only today returning to opera houses and concert halls, was a central figure in pre-Nazi musical life. The number of performances of his operas came close to those of Richard Strauss, and in the early 1920s frequently overtook them. He was thus one of Germany's most performed living composers, in addition to being a highly regarded conductor who had given the premieres of many important works, including Schoenberg's Chorlieder in 1913. He was accorded the ultimate musical accolade when in 1919, one of Germany's most influential critics, Paul Becker, announced that Schreker, among all of Germany's most famous opera composers, including Richard Strauss, was the only obvious successor to Richard Wagner. In 1920, Schreker left Vienna to take up the directorship of Berlin's Music Academy. In 1932, he joined his friend and colleague Arnold Schoenberg at the Prussian Academy of Arts, where he held a composition masterclass. The names of Schreker's pupils, both in Vienna and Berlin, represent a roll call of Central European musical life during the 1920s and 1930s. He was unquestionably one of Germany's cultural giants. Traeger had nevertheless been the object of frequent anti-Semitic vilification even before the Nazi dictatorship in 1933, forcing his move from Berlin's Music Academy to the Prussian Academy of Arts. With Hitler's arrival, there followed a ban on Traeger as conductor and teacher, along with performances with a performance ban on his works. His complete removal from public life, his inability to emigrate, and a vindictive cancellation of the promised pension resulted in a stroke that proved fatal only a few days short of his 56th birthday in 1934. He thus became Hitler's first high-profile musical victim. Traeger most likely never set foot in a synagogue. With a Christian mother, he was by Jewish law not even a Jew. His musical education had been paid for by his godmother, the Princess Windischgrätz, and as a young man, he had played the organ in the local parish church in Vienna. When in 1933, he stood accused of being a Jew under Nazi race laws, his admittedly feeble defense was that his cousin had written the Semigotte. Yet when he completed his most popular opera, the Schatzgräber, on the 12th of November, 1918, the day that Austria lost its empire and proclaimed itself a republic, he scribbled on the bottom of the final page of his manuscript his expectation that Austria would now be annexed by the German Reich. It was a prediction that would be fulfilled with tragic consequences for his family and millions of others 20 years later. You can see the inscription on the margin at the very bottom. Let's listen to an extract from his opera Die Gezeichneten, meaning the branded or those who were marked out, from 1915, in order to get an idea of what Paul Becker might have meant. Traeger's pupil, Ernst Krenig, described his teacher as being the musical equivalent of Gustav Klimt. So we'll listen to a bit of his opera Die Gezeichneten. Was the sound acceptable? Because I think I forgot to click the little box on the screen share that allows me to share tone.
It works. It worked even like this. It worked well.
Oh, okay, fine. Because I can go back and click the little box that shares tone, if that's okay.
Yes.
But if you say it's okay, it's fine.
I think both ways seems to work.
Okay. Well, 1918 was the year when Vienna was reduced to being only the capital of the German-speaking regions of the former Habsburg Austria. It was no more than a tiny impoverished republic made up of mountains and a single crescent of the Danube Valley. Its cultural prospects were not good, and there followed what I would call the Austrian cultural annexation of Germany. Many of Austria's most creative individuals either immigrated to Germany or divided their lives between obsolete Vienna and dynamic modern Berlin. The writer Stefan Zweig reminds us that it was not a natural development. Berlin under Kaiser Wilhelm was a byword for stifling Protestant convention. Munich and indeed Vienna were far more adventurous and experimental. The 1920s would reverse their roles and talented Austrians left in droves. Joining Schreker and Schönberg in Germany were Hans Eisler, Alexander Zemlinsky, Hans Gall, Ernst Toch, along with such theatrical luminaries as Fritz Lang, Max Reinhardt, Josef von Sternberg, and Billy Wilder. The cataclysm of defeat in the First World War resulted in both new developments and a transformation of older ones. Around the turn of the century, modernism was understood, and when I say around the turn of the century, before the First World War, modernism was understood as meaning that which showed an unbeautiful yet hyper-realistic portrayal of life. It was often sexually charged and bristled with dark pre-Freudian eroticism. Yet even this hyper-realistic portrayal of life in all of its brutality was not enough for a group of artists who felt that outward portrayal was insufficient. They wished to express an inner portrayal of life and all of they wished to express an inner portrayal. In pre-First World War Austria-Hungary, this was represented by angst, insecurity, and apocalyptic doom. These were the expressionists, and in many ways could be seen as the nihilistic extension of 19th century romanticism. Expressionism was wild, unruly, and in music, aggressively atonal, while in art, subjects lost their shapes or outlines and were shown only by their colors. Content dominated form. Form was outward, color was inward. In music, this abstraction was most eloquently given voice by Arnold Schoenberg. Listen to the first of his five pieces for orchestra from 1909 called somewhat significantly Premonition. And you can see visually the developments of expressionism in the visual arts by comparing the two portraits of Schoenberg. This is the one painted earlier by Richard Gerstel, and this one painted by Richard Gerstel in 1908 before Gerstel committed suicide. This is, we'll listen to Schoenberg's orchestra work, Opus 16, Vorgefühle, Premonition. Thank you. With the end of the First World War and the New World Order expressed as the Weimar Republic in Germany, the disquieting apocalyptic visions expressed by Schoenberg would appear to have been fulfilled. No such luck. Schoenberg's post-war attempt of imposing order on the chaos of atonal expressionism would result in his development of 12-tone composition. It too, however, was only one constellation of the more sobering world vision that followed the massacre of millions in a pointless war that was ultimately meant to end all wars. Younger composers, however, were also looking at giving expression to this sense of artistic sobriety. Ernst Toch and Paul Hindemith were only two who gave new objectivity, a movement within the visual arts that had started in 1925 in Mannheim, its musical variant. Under this very general classification of new objectivity can be grouped a large number of developments that rebelled against 19th century romanticism and expressionism and took their inspiration from all things mechanical and machine-like. The film Metropolis was perhaps the most obvious cinematic reflection of this movement, but it expanded into music as well. It dominated what was called applied music, meaning music for the new media, broadcasting and film, and even theater began to apply music in a manner not heard before. This rush towards objectivity was taken up by many Jews. Not surprisingly, apart from Schoenberg, very few of them followed an atonal path, and most were attracted to the unemotional, rational world of new objectivity in all of its many guises. That this was the case was confirmed by the non-Jewish Austrian avant-garde composer Ernst Krenek in a conversation he recalls having with the head of music of Austria's Roman Catholic Church, Josef Lechthaler, in 1934. Lechthaler informs Krenek that atonal music is music written by Jews for other Jews and therefore cannot be more than music composed for what he called an exotic minority. Krenek finds this view objectionable, not because of its overt racism, but because Lechthaler appears to be so ill-informed, and tells him that the only Jewish composer he can think of who composed the quote-unquote more dubious types of atonal music was Arnold Schoenberg. Lechthaler was astonished and listed a number of well-known composers in the circle around Schoenberg whom he claimed were Jewish. Krenek informed him that he was wrong. All of them were not only non-Jewish Austrians, but most, such as Arbenberg and Anton Webern, and indeed himself, Krenek, came from military or aristocratic Catholic families. Let's hear the opening, we'll only listen to the opening, of one of the most representative works of new objectivity, Ernst Toch's spoken fugue called the Fugue aus der Geographie. If there was another difference between Berlin and Vienna beyond the commercial opportunities offered by Berlin against which Vienna could not compete, it was Berlin's aesthetic distancing of so-called serious music from its bourgeois base and tearing down barriers between popular and serious genre. Didactic works meant to provide the working class with political instruction was one popular idea, whereas allowing composers to cross genre was another, essentially blurring the lines between serious music and popular music. From 1927, so-called contemporary operas or Zeitopern that reflected modern life with flappers and jazz swept German opera stages, though paradoxically, Ernst Krenek, Max Brann, Karl Rathaus, and Wilhelm Gross, who were the main progenitors of the Zeitoper in this period, were all pupils of Franz Schreker. More interesting and more radical in his concessions to popular music was Kurt Weill, whose collaboration with Georg Kaiser and Bertolt Brecht came to personify modern Berlin. So this is, we'll listen to a historic recording of the Kanonenlied from the Drei Groschen Oper, the Trapni Opera.
John war darunter und Jim war dabei und Schoss ist das Angst geworden. Doch die Armee, sie sah keine Versailles und marschierte hinauf gen Norden. Soldaten wohnen auf den Kanonen, vom Kap bis Kaspihaar. Wenn es mal regnete und es begegnete ihnen eine neue Rasse, eine braune oder blasse, dann machen sie vielleicht daraus ihr Bifteck Tartar. Johnny war der Whisky zu warm und Jimmy hatte nie genug Decken. Aber Schorchi nahm beide beim Arm und sagte, die Armee kann nicht verrecken. Soldaten wohnen auf den Kanonen, vom Kopf bis Kaspihaar. Wenn es mal regnete und es begegnete ihnen eine neue Rasse, eine braune oder blasse, dann machen sie.
Specifically, composed political music for the masses was an idea that took root more readily in Berlin than in Vienna, where the very opposite view was held. Rather than have music talked down, workers should be given the opportunity of accessing music's worthiest qualities, no matter how complex. Serious music was offered to everyone in large-scale workers' concerts, organized by Red Vienna's socialist cultural minister, David Joseph Bach, many of which were conducted by Anton Webern, in fact, or as we presume in this particular photograph, which you can't see very clearly, Ferdinand Loewe. Pre-1945, German-speaking Europe was not limited to Austria, neutral Switzerland, and Germany, but extended across much of Eastern Europe. The Potsdam Conference would agree to the removal of 14 million German speakers living outside of the borders of Germany and Austria, including communities in East Prussia, now Poland and Russia, Bohemia, Moravia, Silesia, which is now part of Poland, the Balkans, and part of the Ukraine. Until then, the German spoken in Prague was considered the purest German spoken in the Habsburg realm and represented what came to be thought of as standard Austrian High German. Most Czech Jews were German speakers, but regardless of whether they were German or Czech speakers, Jews or Christian, their musical developments were distinct from new objectivity or the 12-tone trends dominating Germany or interwar Austria. The Devistil movement for Czechs was more defining than new objectivity and occupied a realm where dream, magic, and reality dominated. It stood in contrast to the stark reality of German objectivity. It was quite often polyrhythmic and based on cadences within the Czech language. It created a trend that could possibly be called new subjectivity. And operas that occupied this phantasmagorical world were Martinus Giulietta, Pavel Haas's The Charlatan, Erwin Schulhoff's Flammen, Victor Ullmann's The Fall of the Antichrist, and Hans Krass's Betrothal in a Dream. We'll listen to the opening of the Betrothal in a Dream, the overture. Martineau and Schulhoff also established a creative bridge between Prague and Paris, bypassing both Berlin and Vienna and allowing Dadaism to flourish. It could be seen as the twisted twin to Czech surrealism, or perhaps its comic offshoot. Schulhoff was particularly taken with Dadaism, and his opera Flammen was a weird and wonderful update of the Don Juan story, though hardly anything surpasses the weird and wonderful of musical Dadaism of his Sonata Erotica for solo female vocalist, in which he notates the sexual act from foreplay to orgasm to the postcoital bedpan, as seen here on the final page of the score. You can see it right at the bottom. The other interwar field in which Jewish composers made an enormous contribution was the music of entertainment. The composer of the White Horse Inn, the non-Jewish Ralph Benatsky, wrote in his diary on the 1st of January, 1928, the following entry. Quote, "There's only one truly good and ideal public, the Jewish one. If there are a number of Jews in a room, there'll be both laughter and tears. There is warmth and gratitude, as well as comprehension and recognition. And if there are a lot of Jews in a city, one can always count on a ready public. The intellectual agility of this race, the ability to comprehend everything in a moment, their cultivation, their talent for punning and wordplay, are ideal for the creative artist. And it is no coincidence that a huge number of this nation is recruited to make up the largest contingent of performers, writers, and composers. Perhaps it's a bit different in the world of so-called serious music, and perhaps this hypothesis should be tested, but I'm quite sure the results would not be that different." End of quote. Those Jews not born to wealth often spoke Yiddish at home with German as second language. The languages are so close to allow endless twists and puns. The death of censorship led to cabaret. The realities of life in the 1920s saw even nice girls and boys on the street trying to earn enough for their next meal, and it provided an awful lot of material. We'll listen to the Lavender Song, written by Misha Spolyansky in 1920.
Makes them think they have the right to say what God considers vice. What makes them think they have the right to keep us out of paradise? They make our lives hell here on earth, poisoning us with guilt and shame. If we resist, prison awaits, so our love does not speak its name. The crime is when love must hide. From now on we'll love with pride. We're not afraid to be queer and different. If that means hell, well, hell, we'll take the chance. They are so straight, uptight, upright and rigid. They march in lockstep, we prefer to dance. We see a world of romance and of pleasure. Can see is sheer banality. Lavender nights, our greatest treasure, where we can be just who we want to be. Round us all up.
I think it's worth pointing out that Spolyansky, who wrote this anthem, this gay liberation anthem, was himself not gay, though he did write it under a different name. Anyway, it was this strong ethical sense that had grown out of emancipation, along with the obvious injustices and corruption of the Weimar Republic, meant that nearly all of the social satire of the day was of Jewish provenance. Even the operettas were far racier than we assume today. With the arrival of the Third Reich, removal of Jews meant the effective removal of nearly all popular operettas. Even Franz Lehár's librettists were Jewish, meaning the Nazis had to rewrite and sanitize already familiar works, such as the Merry Widow. This sanitation of Austro-German operetta would have a deadening effect on the genre. the risque elements were removed and replaced with a sweeter than sweet inoffensiveness. With the Nazi defeat in 1945 and the restoration of many much loved works, the inoffensiveness was maintained as so-called lewd material was stripped away, meaning that only in the last years have we started to experience most of the Silver Age of operetta in the manner the composers and librettists intended. Sobriety and the total discredit of the old order also introduced a secular age that rebelled against church and synagogue. As so often in such a situation, secular religion sprang up in their place with varying types of fascism vying for the hearts and minds of Europe's interwar citizens. That many Jews were drawn to communism needs to be seen in a pre-1917 and more crucially in a pre-Stalinist context. Mainstream political parties were still at worst actively anti-Semitic and in league with the official anti-Semitism of the church, or at best nominally anti-Semitic and using a fear of Jews as a means of garnering the popular vote. It's impossible to generalize the Jewish position within politics, though the playwright Arthur Schnitzler offers us a glimpse in his novel from 1908, The Way Outdoors. In one revealing passage, the wealthy father of one of the protagonists, in defending his Zionist position, makes the observation that it was the Jews who founded the Liberal Party only to be betrayed by non-Jewish liberals. And it was the Jews who had supported pan-German nationalism only to be betrayed by non-Jewish nationalists. He goes on to say that one could expect the same to be true of the Social Democratic and Communist parties in the fullness of time. It was not quite right. Jews gravitated towards social democracy, but quite a few also felt drawn to communism, which called itself the International, since according to the Communist Manifesto, the worker has no nationality. This was a concept that appealed to many intellectual younger Jews who preferred the solidarity of different people united by class as opposed to ethnicity, especially those who sensed their German credentials had never been fully accepted. Few composers took to the dogma of this secular religion with more passion than Hans Eisler. His fight songs, the secular hymns of the secular religion of communism, were indeed so powerful that with the advent of the other great secular religion of the day, National Socialism, his simplistic yet compelling melodies were co-opted with Nazi text, now superimposed on top. Despite many other propaganda songs by Jewish composers such as Kurtweil and Paul Dessau, Hans Eisler invented the idea of German musical agitprop. We'll listen to the solidarity song from the film Kühle Wampe, which was written by Bertolt Brecht. I think you've got the idea there. Perhaps the most long-lasting achievement of the anti-romantic movement post-1920 was that of political theater and cinema. Ernst Toller's personification of the 1920s zeitgeist was a theatrical spectacle called Hoppla, wir leben, or Hey, we're alive. Felix Salten, the author of Bambi and Vienna's most notorious pornographic novel, Josefine Mutzenbacher, reviewed it as follows. Hey, we're alive. The phrase which lends this review its name is heard five times, emanating from various quarters of the stage, from the broadcasting console of the radio studio, from the private dining room where a government minister is taking a bribe, from the office of a journalist from a brothel where a young girl is being taken by an elderly count, and from the dingy dive of a group of workers having a meal. The stage is assembled in such a way that all of these venues are instantly visible and the actions are all concurrent. Various other dramatic devices are employed throughout, such as actors mixing with the audiences, newspaper sellers shouting from the top balcony, extra, extra, before tossing papers, newsprint, and sheets of newsprint on top of the audience seated below. The music was composed by a young Jewish composer born in Vienna but raised in Berlin named Edmund Meisel. Indeed, Meisel and Eisler were almost mirror images of each other. Eisler was born in Germany but raised in Vienna. Both would become political activists and both would work for Piscator's Communist Ensemble Theater in Berlin. But Meisel went on to compose several iconic works, to some degree trumping Eisler as a film composer. First and most famous was his score for Eisenstein's battleship Potemkin from 1925, followed in 1927 by Berlin Symphonie der Großstadt. Meisel died at the tragically young age of 36 in 1930. Eisler and Ernst Toch, however, would escape Hitler and end up in Hollywood. I'm going to try and jump now to a video. Eisler's counterintuitive dialectical treatment of film and music is described in his book, co-authored by Theodor Adorno on composing for films, in which he describes the disjunction between visual and audio creating a synthesis. As an experiment, he set his 12-tone work, 14 Ways of Describing the Rain, to a silent film from 1929 by Joris Evans entitled Rain, which showed clouds gathering and rain falling in Ivan's native Amsterdam. This is an extract from that film. We'll just listen to a little bit, one of the variations. Gives you the disjunction between image and sound. Anyway, Wagner believed Jewish reverence for the past was compensation for the fact that they had nothing creative to say about the present. His evidence for this was Mendelssohn's resurrection of Bach's Matthew Passion and Edward Hanslick's position as professor of aesthetics at Vienna's university, where his Hegelian tract on musical beauty pleaded for a return to classical purity. His lectures on aesthetics amounted to the first examination of music as history, and he was succeeded by Gustav Mahler's childhood friend Guido Adler, the father of comparative musical analysis. Coexisting in Vienna was the Jewish form analyst Heinrich Schenker. Jews showed less reverence for the past than a fascination with it. Schoenberg included, it was seen by many Jewish composers as the backdoor to musical progress. It offered old skin in which to pour new wine. The mood was still rational and anti-romantic, but many composers looked to past templates in order to create something new and individual. Two very different composers who saw the past as the key to the future were Hans Gall and Egon Welles, both of whom were pupils of Guido Adler. If Gall, who had edited the complete symphonic instrumental and chamber works of Brahms, saw Viennese classicism as offering the structures on which he could hang his own personal musical edifice, Welles saw the past as a more expressive device and tried to recreate the pageantry of Baroque opera, with its processions, marches, and lengthy dance sequences as a vehicle in which he could create new experiences. We'll hear the opening of the Bacchantinen, the Bacchanines, offering an example of the incredible energy he was trying to inject into contemporary opera. So the question which demands to be asked is, were there any Jewish composers who held to the models of Wagnerian romanticism, with Schrecker, Zemlinsky, Schönberg, and even Walter Braunfels having left their late romantic tendencies far behind? There were only a few, and they were very much the exception rather than the rule. Certainly the most notable of all was Erich Wolfgang Korngold, the son of the much feared critic Julius Korngold, who had spent a lifetime trashing all development since Mahler, while at the same time puzzling over the extreme modernist works being written under his own roof by his teenage son. With time, however, Erich Korngold's natural talents grew too large for even his powerful father to control, and he moved from the brash chromatic dissonance of his youth to an enlarged Puccini-esque style that led him eventually to team up with colleagues, one of whom was the theater director, Max Reinhardt, and start reworking operettas from Vienna's golden age for modern audiences. With Richard Tauber also on board, he was able to establish financial independence, marry a beautiful former film actress, and purchase a large estate in Austria's scenic Salzkammergut. With his opera, Das Wunder Heliana, clashing with Ernst Krenek's contemporary opera, Johnny Spielt Auf, an opera which offered jazz bands, locomotives, and flappers, Korngold had moved decisively towards the past. Yet it was a style that anticipated his years in Hollywood. Indeed, we'll listen to an extract from Das Wunder Heliana, which arguably was more extreme than anything he actually composed a decade later in Hollywood.
Thank you.
That little extract just reminds us of what Ernst Toch's rather caustic comment when he said that Korngold had been writing music for Warner Brothers all of his life, only he didn't know it when he was a kid at the time. And it comes to no surprise to hear that John Williams relates how Steven Spielberg asked him to write music that sounded just like Korngold. All of these diverse trends were seen as variants within German musical life, and examinations of the media and press of the day confirmed the enormous role that specifically Jewish composers played. Indeed, the Nazi directory of Jews and music, Lexikon der Juden in der Musik, is a veritable nomenclature of interwar musical life and takes us on the journey effectively started by Goldmark, yet confidently established by Mahler. It was a musical environment that was not visibly Jewish until Jews had been removed. It left an enormous hole in German music. To quote Eric's father, Julius Korngold, in his account of fleeing Austria, quote unquote, "What dangers we endured, I shall pass over." Time doesn't allow me to expound on the Nazi removal of Jews from musical life, nor the camps, nor the attempts at re-ghettoizing Jewish artists and performers and cultural leagues. There's much literature in these subjects already, and it's covered to some extent in my own book, Forbidden Music, The Jewish Composers Banned by the Nazis. The question that dangles in the air are those regarding why, with the defeat of Hitler, this musical energy was not instantly reintegrated. There are no simple answers, but denazification simply did not extend to much of the musical establishment. Though the Americans tried very hard to bring all criminals and opportunists to book, they only controlled the single sector. And if debarred in the American sector, there was little to stop former Nazis performing in others. In addition, the Allies had very different approaches to the subject of music. The French shared a passion for it and tried to re-educate Germans away from Germanic monumentalism into the more refined world of French music. The Russians saw music as the simplest means of reestablishing normality following the devastation of the war. Their sector was the first to organize orchestras and broadcasting. The Americans only cared about denazification and took over music venues for the benefit of their own soldiers, excluding all Germans. The British were simply cynical, and being das Land ohne Musik, as the Germans called England, the country without music, kept true to their nature and neither hindered nor encouraged music, settling on a complacent and willing status quo. They believed that it was pointless trying to denazify an entire population. Only the Americans showed any resolve in removing opportunists from positions obtained at the expense of Jewish colleagues, but they showed little enthusiasm for reinstating Jews who had been dismissed in 1933 or 1938. Austria had a uniquely different issue. From 1933 until the Nazi annexation in 1938, there had been a Catholic-dominated, anti-Nazi, corporatist, conservative dictatorship that removed all resistance to Hitler that came from the left. Returning Jews were often excluded in favor of returning political conservatives who had been made to flee the country with the Anschluss. One has only to think of the Baron von Trapp family to recognize the social sector which dominated anti-Hitler resistance in Catholic Austria. The city of Vienna was happy to welcome back Jews, socialists, and even communists, but the rest of the Federal Republic of Austria was less enthusiastic. By 1948, denazification was no longer a priority. Establishing a front within the Cold War was. The sheer complexities and scale of denazification within the arts meant that it was easier to rely on certain musical codifications. Anyone who had composed 12-tone or atonal music was seen as anti-fascist, even if they had composed Nazi propaganda songs and marches during the Hitler dictatorship. Atonality was seen as anti-fascist and anti-Nazi, despite the fact that atonal works had been occasionally performed and indeed promoted during the Third Reich. Within Germany and Austria, it caused what the musicologist Alfred Einstein, in a letter to Hans Gall, referred to as, quote, "a rush to embrace everything that during the Third Reich was decried as cultural Bolshevism," end of quote. Jews who had been participants in the many aspects of new objectivity, cinema, stage and broadcasting, not to mention operetta and cabaret, were seen as part of the problem. All tonal music was seen as residual romanticism, dispersing to be let out again, and romanticism was seen as responsible for Germany's delusions of grand folly. Young German composers rebelled against their elders who'd sold their cultural heritage to Nazi snake oil merchants. As Pierre Boulez observed, quote, "We wanted everything during the first years after the war. That was the context. Imagine a young German like Stockhausen discovering new music after 12 years of Hitler's time, of Nazi time. Can you imagine the desire to get out of that?" End of quote. Ernst Toch, Hans Gall, Hans Eisler, especially Korngold, but also progressive composers like Bethel Goldschmidt, were seen as part of the problem, not the solution. Theirs was called the wrong kind of modernism. Finally, there was the question of cultural ownership. After the mass murder of millions, even Austrians and Germans who genuinely would have welcomed back banished composers and performers were too unsure of how to carry this through practically. Former Nazis and Nazi sympathizers still sat in prominent positions in Austria and Germany. Defeat had not eradicated anti-Semitism or the suspicion of anti-Semitism. Yet composers who had landed in faraway places were not taken up as Americans, British or Brazilians. If they'd been in the fortunate position of being successful before Hitler, it was nearly impossible to repeat that success afterwards in new homelands. Kurt Weill and Eric Korngold did so by being able to accommodate new demands for stage and screen. Excuse me. If Toch remained prominent as a musical figure in America, as soon as he died, his music was forgotten. And with the death of his generation of fellow refugees, he might never have existed. The music of exile is again a long and complicated subject that simply cannot be accommodated in this single presentation. So what's left? Lots of music spread across the globe, all of it attesting to the enormous contribution of Jewish composers made to musical life in one of the most dynamic musical countries in the world during several of the most dynamic musical decades of the 20th century. Much of it is sliding out of copyright into the public domain, meaning publishers have little incentive in restoring what was once very important. Much material remains locked away in garden sheds, cellars, or attics in distant countries. What's still available needs critical editing so that it can actually be performed. Archives in faraway places are unsure of what they possess, and the children and grandchildren of the composers who made up this chapter of 20th century musical history no longer have any sense of identity with the countries that exiled their forebears. Korngold provides us with an example of the combination of debilitating homesickness and mistrust encountered after the war upon returning to his homeland. Few composers would have felt themselves to have been so defeated by post-war developments as Korngold. Following his heart attack in 1947, he escaped into a world of Viennese melancholy with an operetta somewhat appropriately called The Silent Serenade, completed in 1950. Following Korngold's death in 1957, the letters of rejection sent to his wife were both moving and coldly dismissive. Hal Wallace, a producer at Warner Brothers, offered $20 to a Korngold Foundation in a dictated letter typed on internal memo paper. RCA rejected a memorial recording. Rudolf Bing twisted himself into knots to explain why he could not mount Korngold's last opera, Die Kathrin, in New York's Metropolitan Opera. And conductor after conductor rejected his last major work, the Symphony in F sharp, now establishing itself as a true masterpiece of the time. Most of the letters are from the offices of former Viennese friends and colleagues, now prominent American musicians, and are signed by secretaries sending dictated replies in English. Even letters from such formerly close colleagues as Paul Wittgenstein spoke only vaguely of their collaboration and how so very long ago it was, with more than a whiff of embarrassment. Yet one of the most surprising items amongst the Korngold papers held at the Library of Congress is a letter dated 14th of January, 1942 from the Assembly for a Democratic Austria. It is incensed to find out that Korngold had been donating money to the monarchist committee supported by Otto von Habsburg. As it happened, there are also other letters which indicate that he'd been giving money to socialists, communists, Christian Democrats, organizations founded to help Austria's starving children, and another that had sent him a self-imported proclamation from Zurich in dense legal German, which he most certainly probably did not bother to read, regarding the obligations of artists and intellectuals in Austria's approaching post-Hitler's era. Every organization claiming to be anti-Nazi was sent a check for $200. The terrible ambivalence of his love for Austria, the only place he truly felt at home, drove him to want the best for its people, indeed his people. Yet accounts of Nazi atrocities resulted in much mutual suspicion. In 1949, Korngold returned to his country estate near Salzburg, where he discovered that his house was in ruins, overrun by desperate refugees and operating as a center for displaced persons. The police arrested the former caretaker when it was discovered that some of Korngold's possessions had found their way into his lodge. Korngold sold the now derelict mansion and land to the local mayor for the price of a peppercorn and told the police not to press charges against the caretaker, explaining that he had given everything away before leaving Austria. Upon his return to the family villa in Vienna in the upmarket Kottersviertel, which stood in stark contrast to the modest bungalow he had in Los Angeles, he unexpectedly met the neighbor's wife, who blurted out, "Jesus, Maria and Joseph, Professor Korngold, I don't believe my eyes, you've returned to Vienna. When are you going back home?" So thank you very much for all of your attention. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. This is brilliant and gives a survey of something, as you said, much too extensive to be able to survey, but you're the one person that has the encyclopedic knowledge of this swath of culture, and it's amazing to hear you speak. Everyone hears about the Holocaust and the Nazi period spoken from many different aspects, but also from this aspect one notices how much was wiped away. I mean, really such a huge cultural layer. But I wanted to start off asking you a bit about your work now, primarily with exile art, but in all the different ways that you've so significantly contributed to bringing back some of what is possible to be brought back. How did this passion start, and where is your work now?
Well, actually, from 2002 until 2010, I was music curator in Vienna's Jewish Museum, and we put on a number of exhibitions. We put on an exhibition on Toch, Eisler, Schreker, Zeisel, Korngold, Schoenberg, Mahler, the usual suspects. And in all of these, in many of these cases, the musical estates were to be found abroad in different countries. And I was somewhat perplexed, annoyed, shocked, discouraged to discover that in even the most prestigious estates, such as most prestigious archives and libraries, such as the UCLA Performing Arts Archive or the Library of Congress, people had not really been able to archive or respect what these composers and performers had actually achieved before immigration. What they had achieved post-immigration was beautifully presented. But I take Toch as the kind of representative of this dilemma. You would have, for example, Toch's interwar career, which was at least as important and as prominent as Paul Hindemith, whom we know better than Toch today. And yet, UCLA archive had basically focused on Toch's movie music, so the Bob Hope films and things like that. And yet, you know, Toch left movie composition as soon as he could. As soon as the war was over, he just stopped right there and then. And so music, so movie music was not really central to Toch's creative life, but the rest of Toch's life was not really well preserved and was not well presented and was really not available to scholars, because the archivist simply said, you know, we don't speak the languages, we don't know who the people are, we don't know what the documentation means, and so on and so on and so on. The same situation erupted in the case of Karl Rathaus, whose musical estate was held at Queen's College, a music department that he actually founded. And, you know, when he died in 1954, they basically never did anything with the estate, that it was just left in the same shoeboxes that it was delivered in 1954. So nobody had really gone through it. Again, the same excuse. Nobody could speak the languages. There were, in the case of Karl Rathaus, there was correspondence in German and in Polish. And, you know, people didn't know who Jascha Horenstein was. So of course they couldn't really know what to do with that. They lost musical scores, or they mislaid musical scores, or they misfiled musical scores. And so I thought to myself, if there are still musical estates out there in the garden sheds, in the attics, in the basements, we have to be able to bring them back. We have to repatriate them, bring them back to the country from where they originated, digitize them, get them published, get them printed up. And since we sit in the music university or the performing arts university in Vienna, former music academy, we have this ready resource of young, very talented students who sometimes will come to us and say, look, you know, we've got the semester project and we're not going to do a Razumovsky quartet. We'd like to do something else. So we give them a quartet by Julius Bürger or by Walter Brecht or by Hans Gall, which are all in our archive at the moment. And so this is the other thing is that every one of the 30 estates that we've accumulated since 2017 tells a different story from the stories that we have come to know and become familiar with. We all have this concept of fleeing the Nazis, and we think we know what that means. But every one of these stories tells something completely different, and we've discovered things that were utterly and totally unexpected in each one of these stories.
That's incredible. And so you say you have about 30 estates at this point.
Not just mostly composers, obviously, not just Jewish composers. We have one Serbian composer who was persecuted by the Ustasha in Croatia, which were the Nazi sort of partisan movement in Croatia. And we have everything. We draw no differences between genres, so that we have cabaret and popular music, Schlager composers. We have the musical estate of Willem Gross, who wrote Along the Santa Fe Trail and Sails in the Sunset and Isle of Capri and other big hit songs from the 1940s. 1930s, 1940s, still heard in hotel lobbies and in Muzak programs today. We have the estate of another composer who was writing cabaret. We have the estate of a former ballet dancer who, when she arrived in London, found that the only way she could make a living was to write her own cabaret songs and perform them in the venues for refugees. Because particularly Austrian refugees had a difficult position, because Austria no longer officially existed. And so Austrians who still held to an Austrian identity set up their own nightclubs, their own cafes, their own coffee houses in order to maintain their identity. And she wrote her own songs and she performed them there. So, I mean, so it's a wide variety of things. Of course, we have composers who wrote opera. We've recently acquired the estate of a French composer. And most recently, we've acquired the estate of Walter Suskind, whom people generally think of as a conductor, but like Georg Tintner, another estate that we are acquiring, was only a conductor because he couldn't work as a composer once he'd been thrown into exile. It was the only way of making a living in exile. So this is really what we're doing at the moment. We're repatriating these estates, and by repatriation of these estates, every estate tells us something we didn't know and just broadens our knowledge and understanding.
And what are, if you can share, do you have your site set on some particular archives or estates that are to, in your opinion, would be best housed, best served by Exil Arte Center? Are there ones that have your eyes set?
You know, the thing is we've 2017 is when we were established. And so obviously we're competing against national archives and the families out there who say, well, we're sort of, we don't know whether to give it to you or whether we should give it to, you know, the Austrian National Archive or the Polish Archive or the Bavarian State Archive. The thing is that we have as our primary interest, the digitization and the dissemination. This is where we're different from a library and a normal national archive. We want to bring the music out again. We're actually negotiating with publishers. We have put one of our estates, the music of Hans Winterberg with Boosey and Hawks. The first orchestral CD has just come out. We're negotiating with other publishers, Schott and Schirmer's, for other composers or for other lines within our collection. And as to the estates that are still out in the private hands, there are quite a few. They know we exist. We're in communication. People still have to make up their minds. We send them proposed contracts. We tell them the rights will always stay with the heirs. We make no money out of this. We simply want to digitize everything and preserve the original material. We're very lucky that the University of Music and Performing Arts in Vienna gave us hundreds of thousands of euros so that we could create a state-of-the-art archive that houses these original manuscripts, that we can digitize them. They gave us the original building of the Music Academy, where a lot of people went to study. Julius Bürger, Wilhelm Gross, Walter Bricht, even Korngold taught there. We have a few Korngold. In fact, the Korngold family has given us quite a bit of its material now. We are in negotiation, as I said, with other families as well. So I think things look really quite promising for the future.
Fascinating, and what a great project. And I want to ask you, this is all slightly on a personal, more personal note, but this is very much related to the topic. The Leo Kestenberg archive in Israel, you're aware of it?
I know it exists. Yes, I know it exists. And of course, Leo Kestenberg was the kind of catalyst which brought all of these Austrians to Berlin in 1920. And
perhaps it's something that we can speak about also later, because I went to visit it in some sort of distant room in the basement of the basement. And
what a pity if it's not well preserved, because it really is an important archive. He was to Berlin what David Joseph Bach was to Vienna. I mean, he was a kind of social democrat, a real Macher, somebody who really wanted to rectify the wrongs that had gone on before.
Yes, perhaps since he's come up, you could tell briefly about Leo Kestenberg to some of our participants that may
not. Leo Kestenberg was the cultural advisor to the Prussian government. He was not a cultural minister, he was an advisor to the government. And he was actually Austrian or Hungarian, to be honest, originally, but from the Austrian-Hungarian Empire, was a Jew and was responsible for bringing Franz Schreker to the Music Academy, for bringing Schoenberg to the Prussian Academy of Arts, and really was responsible for much of the musical life that took place in and predominantly music education, and the extraordinary dominance that the Berlin Music Academy then achieved from 1920 after Schreker came. If you look at the faculty list, it's just a staggering list of who's who in interwar Europe. You have Feuermann teaching cello, you have Hindemith teaching composition, you have Schnabel teaching music, you have Karl Flesch teaching violin. He also started a music for Tonträger, for radio, a department for radio music and all sorts of things. I mean, it was an extraordinary achievement to be able to support a music institution like the Academy of Music in Berlin, which I think probably during those years that Schreker was there, became the dominant, absolute predominant music institution in Europe at the time. Unfortunately, Gustav Habermann of the Habermann Quartet, and this is where things really get quite complicated, because Habermann was really a protagonist of the modernist movement, but he was a terrible anti-Semite and was no social democrat and hated the social democracy of Leo Kestenberg, hated everything that he thought Leo Kestenberg had inflicted on the Music Academy, and was with Karl Flesch, was also a teacher. He taught violin, and of course his quartet was famous. His quartet was very famous, particularly in the promotion of new music. And he complained that Schreker was bringing in too many Jewish faculty members, and ultimately was able to get together a coalition of anti-Semitic German nationalist non-Jewish faculty members who formed a committee and were able to force Schreker to resign in 1932. Schreker was put on the line. Either he was to get rid of Jewish faculty members or to resign himself, and he chose the option to resign. Leo Kestenberg then gave him the composition class, the master class at the Prussian Academy of Arts as compensation. But unfortunately, obviously, with the takeover of the Nazis in 1933, both Schoenberg and Schreker, who were both at the Prussian Academy of Arts, were thrown out.
When I went to the Kestenberg archive, one of the things I got to see, brought out of, essentially a shoebox, was a rather detailed description correspondence between Kestenberg and Busoni, who was Kestenberg's piano teacher, which always fascinated me. And it's a description of the Verhandlungen between Busoni and the Academy as Kestenberg tries to arrange and succeeds bringing Busoni back after the First World War to Berlin, and the bureaucracy also of these negotiations, and the indignified Busoni and Kestenberg trying to be a Macher and succeeding. And as a...
Well, see, this was already controversial because Italy was the enemy in the First World War. So why would you bring an Italian composer, pianist? And that was already, provocative for Kestenberg to have done that. And of course, then Busoni then did the ultimate dirty deed and died on Kestenberg. So he was, of course, he did manage to teach Kurt Weill and many others. I mean, his composition class was quite remarkable. And Schoenberg was, of course, then the successor to Kestenberg's composition class at the Prussian Academy of Arts.
Well, and this was, of course, the great tragedy of Busoni's life, that he sat between the Italian and the German chair. And so for the Germans, he was much too Italian. And for the Italians, he was certainly no Verdi and no German. But as another aside from Kestenberg, Daniel Barenboim told me that as he would go to school, as he came as a young boy to Palestine at the time, later Israel, and he would go to school and back, and there was a man waving at him from the second floor apartment somewhere in Tel Aviv, and invite him for tea and cookies and tell him about Berlin of the 1920s. That was Leo Kestenberg. Said he would have
incredible. Yeah, it's amazing.
You will see with him on the way back. But the Kestenberg archive is amazing. It's the letters from Einstein. He was trying to get everybody to go to Israel as well. And this twisting of history is absolutely incredible in that way. I wanted to ask you, actually, so stepping slightly back, and this is to the Jewish composers in the 19th century, the composition teacher, the Salomon Yadason, Judason, the one that was also teaching Busoni and Grieg and
This was in Leipzig, right?
Yeah.
He was part of the he was part of the Yadason was of course part of the kind of old Germanic school of Mendelssohn. You know, it is so ironic that the new school, which was Wagner and Liszt, were actually much older than some of the progenitors of the old school, such as Brahms. And but of course, the old school was very much the view that form determined content, whereas the new school was very much of the view that content determined form, which is why, of course, the new school took to the idea of taking literary sources and saying, well, we can't just stick to sonata form to create Manfred or some other great literary thing, Alte Sprache Zarathustra, or whatever. We can't just stick to the traditional forms. We have to invent our new forms. In fact, we just take this literary idea and we let it determine the form that it takes. And that was the new school. But Yadison was a remarkable composer, very much in the Brahmsian sort of mold.
The list of students, I pasted the link to the article for
all right.
The list of his students is just staggering. So yes, a rather seemingly conservative composer, but everybody from Delius to Albinus and Grieg and Busoni and
amazing.
Yeah. And,
everybody went to Leipzig to study, particularly in England. All the English went to Leipzig to study. I think at that. In those late 19th century days, that was really considered the top conservatory in the world probably at the time.
Yes, as a reminder to everybody, as we're sitting here discussing that, that your questions and comments are very welcome and much appreciated. And there is somebody I believe that Michael Herschel,
yes, from Dresden. Hello. Yes,
I wanted to say hello, and let me see. I think if everything works, then Michael should be able to actually say hi to us in voice and tell us about some recent performance.
Hi, Michael. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Lovely to see you. It's been too long. It's been too long. I've been a big fan of Michael's work, and he's shown me the archive one time when we were both in Vienna at the same time. But usually we're not in Vienna at the same time. maybe this summer it'll work. I wanted to say that. Of course, such an archive as is being built up in Vienna now is so important to make music available. But at the same time, I find that my my conductor colleagues are more than reluctant to play the music. And so the next most important thing, of course, is having performances, which is why we founded this ensemble, now Jüdische Kammerphilharmonie, back in 2007. And we've been traveling around. The Saxon government has made it possible for us to have some nice performances outside of Dresden. We went to Israel, went to Poland, we went to France. And just a few days ago, we had our first concert in Nordrhein-Westfalen in Cologne. And I sometimes forget, this is, Michael, you'll find this funny, the normal audience reaction, for example, the Wachsmann Sinfonietta that we have often at the end of our program. And normal audiences, like the ones in Köln, you know, they jump to their feet and there's a big standing ovation and so on and so on. And it was very nice to have that for a change, because Saxon audiences are so phlegmatic. They hardly ever say bravo or get to their feet for any reason. You know, maybe if Tielemann is doing Beethoven 9, you know, that might get them off their seats, but that's about it. So anyway, the music, performing this music by this school that you've been talking about, the idea that there's this sort of post-romantic chapter of German music that just got eradicated, because after the war, it was right off to Stockhausen, as you were saying. And that hasn't really changed. There's the fact that people don't know the names of these composers still. I mean, and our audience now does, because we, you know, at the Dresden Synagogue, we perform regularly. And so our audiences now know who Wachsmann was and some of the other names, maybe even, you know, Fittelberg and Lavry and some of the others. And because of, I don't want to talk too much about what we've been doing recently, I have followed the model of Mahler, which is to take chamber music works that nobody ever plays and transcribe them for my ensemble so that they would at least get there. I did a transcription of the Korngold's Opus 10 Sextet, for example, which is very symphonic, actually, when you play it with a larger group of strings, or the Weinberg trio, Opus 48. And we're actually going to perform at the Festspiele now in a couple of weeks. We're going to do the Weinberg Concertino and the Second Symphony. Anyway, so it's still, after doing this for 15 years, I still have the impression that mostly audiences just still do have no idea that this music exists. And they're very enthusiastic when they get to hear it. We always hope that word of mouth will sort of get it out. But it's still sort of a big uphill battle, and there's still so much unperformed music. So keep doing what you're doing.
I think also it's a question of propriety. It's a question of who owns a composer. We have a big problem with composers like Ullmann or like Rathaus. You know, Rathaus, I always take as an example. Rathaus is a composer born in Tarnopol, was a patriotic Austrian, was an Austrian until 1938. He spoke Polish at home, but his German was obviously his dominant language. He went to German schools and he got his doctorate in Vienna, and he studied with Schreker in Vienna, and he studied, with Josef Hoffmann piano in Vienna, and then he got his doctorate in law in Vienna. So, I mean, he was doing these things at the same time. He went to Berlin, where he made his main career. You know, Erich Kleiber did his opera, Fremde Erde, George Zell did his ballet, Der letzte Pierrot. Kiesecking played his piano music, Furtwängler conducted his orchestral music. He was the first composer to write a film score, for a serious music composer to write a film score for Ufa. And when Hitler came, he went to Paris, continued writing film music. Then he went to London, where the Royal Opera House gave him a commission, and then a BBC offer of a job, which he had to turn down because he was seen as a foreigner and couldn't take the job, which is when he went to America and then was stuck by the war. And then, went undercover basically and became a music teacher, and nobody knew what he had done before he came to America. Nobody had any idea of who he was. And the problem is that for the Austrians, he was Polish. For the Poles, he was Ukrainian. For the Ukrainians, he was Polish. For the Germans, he was Austrian. For the French, he was German. You know, for the English and the Americans, he was foreign. So until somebody claims a composer, you can't get them performed, because in this environment which we have today, we are totally dependent on some subsidy saying, oh, he's one of us.
Nationalism, you know? And ironically.
This is very at the moment what's happening. I wanted to say, there was only one person in America who really knew about Ratos and who talked to everyone about him, except it was Benny Herman, and nobody wanted to listen to him. Benny Herman was extolling Rathaus film scores from UFA, you know, way back in the 40s and even earlier. But right now, one of the hats, I also wear several hats. One of my other hats is that I'm the president of the Jewish community of Dresden. And so Ukrainian refugees are coming in. And we're having this very strange situation because in Saxony, about two-thirds of the communities are Ukrainian and less than one-third are Russians. And in Germany, everybody is wondering how long things are going to stay quiet between the different constituents of the Jewish communities. But in music, people are having these arguments, you know? You know, what do you mean Horowitz is a Ukrainian? You know, he's a this, he's that, you know, or what do you mean so-and-so was born in Riga? He's still, you know, he's a Russian through and through. So there are these strange, in the Jewish community anyway, there are these strange arguments in terms of laying claim. This is what made me think of it. Laying claim, who belongs to whom? I might also say that as far as the more established composers go, it is very discouraging for smaller ensembles like us that some of the larger publishing houses are so unrelenting in the fees that they demand for performance fees, because it is not good for the dissemination of, yeah. I mean, the Symphonische Serenade, right? Which was the first piece by Kronberg that we played. Yeah. I remember how horrified we were, and we'd say, oh, we would like to play it a lot more often, but it's just prohibitive. So anyway, yeah.
That is the perennial problem. I have no idea how to get around that. And yet we need publishers for the dissemination process. This is it, you know?
Yeah. Of course. Thank you, Michael. It's great to hear from you. And I'll definitely be looking out for your work. But it's wonderful that you're joining us.
It's a great pleasure. Thanks. Take care. Stay healthy.
Take care, Michael. Thanks.
In this direction, I wanted to ask you, does your center, I mean, you're clearly busy enough, but does your center have time to be involved in performance activities or to think of ways of, as Michael was just talking about, disseminating this music, making it sound again?
Well, that's our most important job. I mean, we do have a series of concerts, which we had been putting on together with the ORF, with Austrian Radio. The pandemic sort of broke everybody's existence, you know, and broke everybody's routine up. And so, yes, we do. We have a series of concerts. As I said, we also have an exhibition floor. We teach a module as well on exile, on the music of exile, but also it's really a bit of a misnomer, because exil Musik is the elegant way of trying not to say entartete Musik, because entartete Musik means, of course, you're using a Nazi term, which many people find offensive. Well, it is offensive, but of course it's the dialectic of using this offensive term in order to rehabilitate music that was originally marginalized. But people don't see it that way. And so they've come up with this idea of exil Musik. Exil Musik, you know, the music of exile, what is that? You can't include Mendelssohn because he wasn't exiled. You can't include Schreker because he died in 1934. You can't include Krasse because he was murdered in Auschwitz. So, you know, but you still have to call them something. So we call them exil exil Komponisten, even though they weren't obviously exil Komponisten, they were, but that just has to be the terminology that we use. But we do, yeah, obviously we have kids, the students who come to us, we have exchange programs, we have Fulbright students who are working with us at the moment. We are putting on a conference in June called Modernism in Hollywood, with the musicology department as well, and also, as you know, with a visiting professor from California. So getting the music out there is the most important thing. We do put on concerts. We can't pay for concerts. We need partners. Obviously, we just don't have a budget for that, but we do have a budget for all these other activities. That's and fun. Within the context of the Musikhochschule, or within the context of the Musikuniversität, we do have a budget, obviously, for putting on concerts.
That's fantastic. Maybe as we sort of turn a full circle, it would be interesting to hear you talk about some of the composers that you think are the ones that we ought to look at next. I mean, I think there is, with much help of yours, there's more and more awareness of Haas and Ullmann and Klein, and one can name a number of people. But what are some of the pieces, and who are some of the composers that you feel, well, this is really a shame that quote unquote we sort of a community of interested and open-minded people that play, that listen, that go to concerts, should really be looking at, that you think are really undeservedly in the shadows?
Well, I think the most important one that we have at the moment is Hans Winterberg. And the Hans Winterberg story is quite a complex story. When I was saying that we're learning things about exile that we did not know before, the Winterberg story is one of a composer very much like Hans Krasser. They studied with the same piano teacher. They both studied with Zemlinsky. They have a very similar post-Janáček style of Czech music. As I was saying in the presentation, you know, the Czechs had a very distinctive style of composition. And what we learned in the story of Hans Winterberg is that when Czechoslovakia was formed in 1918, it inherited the multi-ethnic community of the former Habsburg Empire. And in 1930, the Czech government held a census to try and establish the ethnic makeup of this new republic, and discovered that 24% of the population spoke German, but there were also huge numbers of Ukrainians, Poles, Czechs, Slovakians, and Hungarians. These were all minorities, all living in this new country called Czechoslovakia. And what was significant is that on the basis of how you marked yourself on this census in 1930 became the basis of whether or not you were then thrown out of the country in 1945. So everybody who marked themselves as German, as a German speaker in 1930, found themselves disappropriated and expelled from the country in 1945 under the Benes decrees. Now, most Jews were German speakers, and the last place they were going to be expelled to was Germany or Austria. And so quite often they found themselves in these camps for displaced persons. But in the case of Winterberg, which is quite interesting, and it would have been the case for Schulhoff as well and for Pavel Haas, is that he had actually marked, even though he spoke German at home, he had marked himself on the census as Czech. So that spared him being expelled in 1945. But obviously it didn't spare him from the persecution of being a Jew by the Nazis during the occupation. And he went to Germany in order to his wife, his ex-wife now, because of the Nazi laws, he had to divorce his non-Jewish wife and his half-Jewish daughter. They went to Germany, they went to Munich, and in 1946, he applied for a Czech passport, got a Czech passport in 1947, went to Germany, was reunited with his wife and daughter. And in 1948, there's the communist coup in Czechoslovakia, and he decided, it appears he decided to stay in Germany. Now, the only way he could stay in Germany was if he made himself a displaced person, a refugee. But he wasn't a refugee. He had a Czech passport. He had arrived in Germany quite legally as a Czech. citizen. And but he wanted to stay in Germany, and he could not stay in Germany as a Czech citizen. So he began to invent this new existence of himself as a German-speaking Czech refugee. The music was taken up by the Munich Philharmonic and by the radio orchestra, the Bavarian radio orchestra. There are many, many, many recordings of his music, the symphonies, the piano concertos, the ballets, symphonic works that were recorded in the 50s, 60s, 1970s, and 80s. He died in 1991 at the age of 90. And, you know, he was very, very prominent. Now, the problem was, is that he was known by the other Sudeten Germans, the other Czech Germans, as being somebody who had noted himself as Czech, not as German in the 1930 census. So there was a lot of suspicion that he was just trying to pass himself off for being a Sudeten German when in fact he wasn't. And when he died, his estate ended up in the Sudeten German Music Archive, which embargoed the estate for 40 years after his death, till 2031. And would not let anybody have access to it. And once the estate embargo had been lifted in 2031, it was never to be made known that he was Jewish, and he was only to be performed as a Sudeten German composer. Well, of course, he was no more of a Sudeten German than Hans Kafka. So this was just a complete lie, and this was an agreement that was made with a publicly funded institution in 2002. So it was really a bit of a shock. Randy Schoenberg sent me, the grandson of Arnold Schoenberg, sent me the contract. I put it on my blog, and we lifted the embargo almost immediately, managed to get hold of the manuscripts, digitized the manuscripts, and hold on and disseminated, get it to Boosey and Hawks, who have now decided that actually Hans Winterberg is one of the most prominent post-war orchestral composers out there. And I think that, you know, we're hoping to get some big name composers interested in his music, big name conductors interested in his music. There are now two CDs of his piano music. The piano music is fantastic and needs to be looked at. There are four piano concertos, which Jonathan Powell is now recording, and two symphonies, a number of ballets, which I would compare with The Miraculous Mandarin. And so I think that that's one of the most important estates we have. Another important estate is Hans Gall. But to be honest, Hans Gall, everything is out there. People are performing Hans Gall. Hans Gall is almost being re-established. The chamber music is out there. The piano music has been recorded twice. The chamber music has been recorded twice. There are two complete recordings of the symphonies. The operas are finally being performed and recorded. So that's another important estate that we have. But one estate which also intrigues me and is rather tragic is that of Walter Bricht. Walter Bricht was a pupil of Franz Schmidt and was, I think, until 1938, one of the most productive composers of his generation. And if you go through the newspapers in Austria, there's not a month that goes by when Bricht is not presented as a composer or as a conductor or as a pianist or as an accompanist or as an organist or as a choir director. The Vienna Philharmonic was about to perform, the Vienna Philharmonic has premiered his first piano concerto, the Vienna Symphony had premiered his symphony, the Clemens Krauss was about to perform his second piano concerto and the symphony with the Vienna Philharmonic when the Anschluss took place. And when the Anschluss took place, to his amazement, Bricht discovered he was 3/4 Jewish, which under Nazi law meant he was a full Jew. I think Clemens Krauss and others got together and offered him the opportunity of becoming an honorary Aryan. He turned it down and made contact with a friend of his who worked at the American embassy, managed to immigrate to the United States. And even though he was also one of the composers who wrote for the one-armed pianist, Paul Wittgenstein, he wrote a piece for Paul Wittgenstein when he arrived in the United States, but circumstances and the existence in exile completely overwhelmed him and he stopped composing, which is extraordinary because this was one of the most productive Austrian composers of his generation. And so what we have is a real testimony to his work in Austria prior to immigration. When he died as a teacher at Bloomington, Indiana, nobody, again, like Karl Rathaus, nobody had the faintest idea who he was. So again, there's a big repository of piano music. There is a good deal of orchestral music, a good deal of chamber music, but all written prior to immigration. So that's another important estate. I mean, I could go on. We have another four or five. We're just in the process of acquiring some. I think it's interesting to look at the works of these conductors who had been composers prior to becoming conductors, like Georg Tintner and Walter Suskin, because they also were, you know, going in different directions, directions which were contrary to these dominant pillars we think of as German, Austro-German 20th century music, you know, Neusachlichkeit on one side and the Schönberg Second Viennese School on the other side. And yet there was such a plurality of music that didn't conform to either of these two pillars.
This is fascinating and very enticing. Actually, one important, and it's well certainly in the air, it's very much something that's discussed in classical music right now, among other parts of art and society. What about any female composers? Of course, there were a number of female.
Marin also, you know, also keeps asking me this question. The only one we've got is the cabaret composer, unfortunately. You know, the problem is who are the female composers who we know about? There's Kapralova, who died when she was very, very young as she was leaving Paris.
Tuberculosis, no?
The music is rather, it's very good music. There's no question. It's good music, but it's not particularly distinctive. She was totally.
I think these April preludes for Ferkuschny are quite nice.
Yeah. And there's also Vali Weigl, who most of her compositions were written in the United States after the death of her husband, Karl Weigl. Again, it's beautiful, a lot of it, really beautiful, beautiful music. Some of it would you'd have to say is reactionary, going back, you know, but I think in a way it's many people like Robert Fürstenthal, for example, just felt that in a way being an exile freed you to write in any style you liked, and they didn't feel compelled to try and keep up with whatever the latest aleatoric or electronic tape trend might have been at the time, and they just wrote the music they wanted to write, probably thinking, well, nobody's going to play it anyway, so I might as well just write what I want to write, and maybe one day somebody will like it.
Yeah. Interesting. Well, one hopes for discoveries. And who were the cabaret composers you... Yeah.
Well, with the cabaret composers we have, as I said, the female composer that we have, oh, God. The name, I'm sorry, I'm having a senior moment trying to remember all of their names.
Oh, it's amazing names you remember.
Yeah, I mean, exactly. We have, I think, probably two estates of popular music. We have several estates of operetta composers. I mean, again, one of the estates we have of Robert Frey. This is, again, an interesting composer. His real name is Freistadl. He collaborated with Max Reinhardt in Berlin on an operetta called Die Wirtin in Venedig. I don't know what you'd call that, the hostess in Venice. And when the Nazis came, it couldn't be put on. And so, and when you think that at that time, Max Reinhardt was usually working with Korngold, so it's extraordinary that he then turned to this guy, Robert Frey, who'd been writing Schlager, you know, hit songs at the time. But the operetta moved to Vienna, where it ran for 4 years. And then when it came off in 1936 or so, then another operetta by Robert Frey was put on instead. And then, of course, you know, the Anschluss took place. He fled to England. He was a very wealthy man, but he couldn't take any of his money or possessions with him. He was interned on an internment camp. And the extraordinary thing is that we have scraps of manuscripts. We have things from him. The most important thing we can say about Robert Frey is we don't know anything about him, you know? Or there's another composer who wrote art songs in Berlin. We know he was published. We know he was in the Lexikon der Juden in der Musik. We know he was persecuted, and yet we have no information about him. And so that's the tragedy of a lot of the composers that we have, is that the most important thing we can say about, the most significant thing we can say about them is we don't know anything about them. But we know that they were important. We know that at some point, the music establishment believed in them and either gave them a contract, a publishing contract, or gave them concerts, or gave them a platform, or gave them performances.
Oh, it's tantalizing, and as I said, terribly poignant, and at the same time, it is somehow reassuring and uplifting that that with your work, you are giving the sounding of the memory and the trace these people could leave before the tide of history so violently upended their lives or destroyed them.
I think it's also a chapter of history that actually took place that people forgot or preferred not to remember. And there was this dynamic plurality in the interwar years that people just have not, well, they're coming to it now. I mean, the F-sharp symphony by Korngold, now to say that is not a masterpiece is now to just almost be idiotic. It's something that Petrenko is now doing on tour with the Berlin Philharmonic, and it's now being performed with every orchestra you can think of, and, you know, even Korngold's operas. As Leon Botstein said, you know, 2 years ago when he put on a Korngold festival at Bart College, he simply said, it's no longer embarrassing to say that Korngold was a very important composer. And so I think there is, despite what my friend Michael Herschel said, I do think that there is a tide that is turning. It may take a while because people have become apprehensive about hearing unfamiliar music. But then when they discover that the unfamiliar music is not as daunting as they feared, and in some cases actually quite uplifting and inspiring, and tells them and shows them things that great art always shows them about themselves, then I think that we can start to re-examine this period in the 20th century, you know, which is at the moment just a great vacuum.
Absolutely. Perhaps one final question, and it's perhaps the unanswerable question. You've, in your wonderful presentation, the subsequent conversation, the term anti-Semitism has come up a number of times. And of course, I think one has to say that anti-Semitism is just one form directed towards one particular group out of many ways of being racist and violently racist towards a specific group of people. But obviously it's a phenomena that's thousands of years old. It's a phenomena that has had these violent outbreaks, such as the period we've been mainly concentrating on today, it's not a phenomenon that has gone away. Even as we speak, you have spent a lot of time considering this theme. Do you volunteer any general observations or root causes or some trends that particularly strike you about this term, this phenomena that we've mentioned so many times today?
Well, it's very difficult because, of course, I mean, so much of anti-Semitism contemporary anti-Semitism is disagreement with Israeli politics today. And to be honest, I can cite hundreds of London Jews who are not happy with Israeli politics. You know, being a Jew does not mean you have to agree with what Israel is doing. And this is a big problem. And of course, this is very difficult to get through people's heads sometimes. And just by being a Jew doesn't make you automatically an apologist for Israel. And so it is a big problem, obviously. People always look for opportunities to be anti-Semitic, but you know, it's also, people also look for opportunities to be racist, you know, and the fact is that it's very difficult. As I said in the presentation, music wasn't particularly Jewish until Jews were removed, and then all of a sudden they discovered how Jewish music was when there were no more Jews in them. You know, it was a bit like saying, well, let's get rid of all the homosexuals in Broadway, you know? And then all of a sudden, you know, where's Broadway? There's nothing left, you know? So it's a difficult thing. People always have this innate prejudice against the unknown, the unfamiliar. I think the only real danger for anti-Semitism is, of course, we have seen what happened. We've seen what's happened in the Holocaust. We've seen the attempted genocide, is that we are so focused on anti-Semitism that we're not seeing, or we're ignoring, discrimination that's happening elsewhere against other groups of people.
I've wanted to say that, and just... Yeah. By being Jewish, I think, you know, there's plenty of other, and at this point, much more festering racial trends and violence inflicted on other groups. But it is also something that we noticed, that this one has been a very persistent and long tradition. But as you
said, it is the longest and it's persistent. And people will always welcome an opportunity to say, "Oh well, of course, Hitler wasn't always wrong," you know.
And just as you said, I think it's very important to the point that you make. You know, just by being Jewish does not make you an apologist for the actions of the current Israeli government. And I can name you hundreds of free thinking Russians that certainly do not condone the actions of the current Russian government. But
of course, yeah, I know. I'm working with one now, as a matter of fact, who's a professor at Queen's College, where we're working on the Rathaus estate together. And, you know, he's going completely, absolutely has no enthusiasm for what's happening and is appalled, shocked, horrified at what's happening.
Yeah. But it is also, even in our cultural world, I think it's very hard to keep that distinction between people that are affiliated with Russian culture, Russian language, and again, the actions of
this was again a big problem in England in 1940, where everybody who was not only a German refugee, a refugee from Nazi Germany, who was interned into internment camps, they also interned people who were second generation German, you know, so people who had even arrived long before Hitler and were second generation German. It was just assumed that if you were German, you were a supporter of Hitler, even if you were a Jewish refugee. And so everybody was deported to the Isle of Man, where Hans Gahl kept a diary. And in his diary, he more or less says that what I believe is happening is that they've just put us all here so that when England falls to Hitler, they've got us all in one place and he can just hand over the Jews on a silver platter, you know. And so it's the idea that all Russians are supporting Putin is just as crazy as the idea. And of course, apparently there's this massive brain drain taking place in Russia at the moment as young people leave Russia to get away from what's happening, who are informing themselves. I mean, I can't say I'm no expert. I can only say what I read in our media, which is clearly very, very different from what Russians are reading in their media.
Yeah, well, let's put it this way. I think there are a lot of drains happening all over the world today, including the drains of brightest and youngest either leaving or perishing. And that's not just in Russia. And, you know, that is Israel. That is the countries in the Middle East. But somehow concentrating on the beacons of culture, of music, I think work and precious work at restoring some of the heritage that would otherwise be lost is one of those beacons. And for that work, I think we're also thankful for your blog that I encourage everybody to read, the Forbidden Music blog, the book. And I hope we can continue this conversation. You gave us, as we corresponded, you gave us a bit of an overview, much more than seemingly possible in this short time, but perhaps at the next opportunity, we can maybe choose a specific composer or two and allow ourselves to delve even deeper.
With pleasure. Absolutely. I would love to do that.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody, for taking part. And I look forward to meeting all together in various next constellations.
Thank you very much, everybody.
Have a good night.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.